Homo sapiens. The final stages in which black people became godlike white people is only one reason this concept has been thoroughly discredited.
Humans have always been conceited about their place in nature. If you look at other animals and the way they evolve, there is no highest mouse, there is no highest antelope.
But there is wide variety in most other species. Land iguanas, marine iguanas, 32 kinds of seals and sea lions, 13 kinds of Darwin's finches in the Galapagos. We are the exception. There is only one variety of Homo sapiens today. It was not always so. 1.5 million years ago, there may have been many human species ranging the Earth.
Creatures evolve according to branching bushes, and the history of human evolution is very twiggy, very bushy. One anthropologist recently counted 17 different fossils that were part of the hominid or the human lineage, and we are the sole surviving twig.
So primates like AZ the orangutan are not a link along the way from lizards to humans.
Atta boy. Good. Very nice. Good job. Got it?
AZ and other primates are twigs on an entirely separate evolutionary bush. We humans have been experimenting for years in hopes of finding a connection from their bush to ours.
Now watch. You have to find the right picture.
One example? Research attempts to determine if primates like AZ can learn human language.
Are orangutans capable of using language? The answer is yes. Are they ever going to use the kind of language that I'm using right now? No. The great apes are not getting into the same level of ability that humans get into.
Perhaps poetry is not necessary unless one finds oneself to be a poet. Then, sweetest flower, 'tis more than necessary. 'Tis my life's blood, and you are my muse.
Nay, I cannot be thy muse, though I greatly admire thy poetry and thy wit.
Human language enables us to talk about the past and the present and the abstract, and yet it is layered over a more primitive, emotive language that we do share with the other animals and the other primates.
If they say every great artist must suffer, then me being married to my wife should make me the greatest artist ever lived.
Why did humans evolve the ability to use complex language? Some evolutionists suggest we need to look more closely at a theory Charles Darwin first proposed more than a century ago. Sexual selection. The idea that organisms compete to attract mates. After all, sex is as important to the long-term survival of a species as our fleet feet, sharp claws, and powerful jaws. Sexual selection helps explain the ornate feathers of a peacock.
Peacock's tail is not a survival benefit. It makes the peacock more vulnerable to getting eaten by tigers. But it's attractive to the peahen, and that is enough for it to evolve.
Other evolutionary psychologists propose that sexual selection was central to the development of the human intellect, our ability to create music, art, and poetry. They theorize such abilities evolved not to increase the chance to survive, but to increase the chance for a mate. Human intellectual expression serves as sexual ornamentation, our version of the peacock's tail.
With music, you see the clearest analogies to other animals. Bird song and whale song evolved to attract mates, and all the complexity and creativity that you see there is there because of sexual selection. Human music isn't that different.
Some language is simple, fulfilling daily functions.
Now don't be shy, get up there on deck.
A working vocabulary of 4,000 to 5,000 words. Yet the average person knows 60,000 to 70,000 words.
Get out of there!
words rarely used.
You look at this fantastically elaborated gift that we have for language and for understanding each other, for empathizing with each other's turns of mind. What drove that? It's as fantastic as the peacock's tail, at least. And maybe it was sexual selection that drove it.
Even when friends get together to gossip, there may be a connection to the way our brains evolved.
9 of us in the hot tub.
Naked.
Yes. And then the bubbles are bubbling. We start falling, you know, like we're just laying back relaxing. And then this hand creeps over. I'm like, whose hand is this? I swear to God.
Gossip clearly is not just a cultural invention because it's so universal across all known cultures throughout history. People have always recognized that humans are just highly talkative animals, and you give them any opportunity to talk to each other, and they will.
This guy looks at me and says, "Are you wearing a slip under that skirt?"
No way.
Yeah. And I told him he was disgusting, and then he started laughing and making tongue gestures. You know?
Like what?
But if you look at what kinds of things people talk about when they're gossiping, a lot of it is information about other people. Are they in a relationship? What are their personality attributes? Are they reliable and moral characters?
Sexual selection is wildly unpredictable. 2 species of birds in the Galapagos provide an example. The red-footed booby has evolved red feet because the female boobies, over millions of generations, have chosen that color. It's the same idea, but a different color in the case of the blue-footed booby.
The fact that sexual selection is unpredictable, that it's hard to model, and it's hard to go back in time and say, why did it happen in this way, in this particular species, has given nightmares to biologists.
So when you ask a question like, why do humans have such complicated language, there isn't an answer to that. We can talk about how we use it, what kind of mental machinery we need to generate it, how we compare to other species and so on. But when it comes to evolution, there's not an answer of why or an answer of yes or no or an answer of a specific goal.
There is only one fact in evolutionary science on which all agree. The genetic code, twined in the double helix, guides the way our bodies form and controls the daily life processes. The role evolution plays in complex human behavior is less certain and the subject of endless scientific debate. Do we control our own behavior, or is it in our genes? Bridget Riley calls herself Baby Doll and is one of the top woman boxers in the world. She excels in what has traditionally been purely a man's sport.
All my ladiness goes out the door when I'm in here.
Baby Doll grew up in a home of sports enthusiasts. She has 3 brothers. She was the only girl. Did her home environment, male-dominated, spur her interest in being a boxer? Or was it something in her genetic makeup?
What we can say is that we are highly influenced by both genes and culture. I've personally solved it myself. I have free will, and you don't. And in